So I had a patient recently that had been worked up in the past for high fibrinogen levels. He was very concerned about it. And my policy is to go ahead and get a lab if a patient's concerned about it, unless there's some major reason not to do so. I tend not to follow fibrinogen. And this video is a discussion on why. Fibrinogen was first discovered to be a risk, 30, 40 years ago. Here's one of the original studies. It was Framingham. You've heard of Framingham. It's the large study up the Harvard folks used it. It was a community longitudinal study. They discovered that fibrinogen, and some others as well, fibrinogen was strongly associated as a risk factor for cardiovascular disease. The impact of fibrinogen value, this was in 87, by the way, in JAMA. So it was a big deal at the time. The impact, considered as a separate variable, was as comparable to major risk factors such as blood pressure, hematocrit, being overweight, cigarette smoking. Again, it was seen as a big deal. Now, you started to get a lot of information from groups like LEI. This is an LEI article which basically describes a lot more about fibrinogen, how it kills, agents that lower fibrinogen, etc. That was, again, still at least 10 years ago. Now, let's get a little bit closer to present day, and you'll see there was an update in the American Journal of Epidemiology. That's an excellent journal. This was 1992, so now we're going from 40 years to about 30 years, 20, 30 years. And they did surveillance on about 1,300 people. They did find fibrinogen as a risk factor. It was very much associated. And here's one of the reasons why fibrinogen has fallen out of favor. It's very much associated with the other risk factors, such as cigarette smoke, especially, but also high blood pressure, diabetes, obesity, etc. So yes, you heard me mention those in the originals, and yes, same thing here. Fibrinogen is associated with being obese, smoking, blood pressure, all of the other, or most of the other standard risk factors for cardiovascular disease. So you begin to get the picture that maybe the things that I do to manage all of those is also going to manage fibrinogen. Well, actually, one of the things that this article says is they thought it appeared to be, from statistical analysis, an independent risk factor, which means that you take that. So, however, there is an independent contribution of fibrinogen to cardiovascular disease in general, hypertensive diabetics, and cigarette smokers. About half the cardiovascular risk of cigarette smoking appears to be due to higher fibrinogen levels. So again, these fibrinogen is tied up with the other risk factors. There is some independence, but the question is, how is that independence impacted when you manage those other risk factors? And I think that's one of the major conundrums that we have with fibrinogen. Now, again, for those of you who are big LEI, Life Extension Institute fans, an article, about 10 years ago, 06, 08 era, mentioned the top 10 tests that LEI would do for cardiovascular risk screening. Item number two was fibrinogen. So again, those guys felt that it was very important to look at it. Now, let's get a little bit closer to today. This article actually is a very interesting article to me and for our purposes, because one of the things that that I do look at a lot is plaque, CIMT. I've got several series on plaque. Now, these guys actually decided to take a look at association between plasma fibrinogen and non-calcified plaque, which is, again, hot or unstable plaque and mixed coronary atherosclerotic plaque. So they did go on. Now, this is in an interesting journal, too. It's the Biology of Sex Differences. So they did find a difference in gender on this specific area. This was 2018. So again, fast forwarding to present time regarding fibrinogen and fibrinogen's continuing link up with all of the other indicators and risk factors for heart attack and stroke. what was their methods? They took, we'll go to the next slide. That'll help us show a little bit more about that. They took 329 subjects and they looked at plaque. They also looked at fibrinogen levels using what's called enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay. That's another long term. People just call it by ELISA. It's a lab test where you basically find an antibody, label it, and then use that antibody to find what you're looking for. In this case, fibrinogen. Again, that part's more of the geeky stuff for those who are interested. The reality is, and the basic message is this, for patients that had plaque, this NCP plaque, that's non-calcium plaque, they've mentioned that before here, non-calcified, the NCP plaque and the mixed plaque had significantly higher fibrinogen. So if you had plaque, whether non-calcified or mixed, you still had higher fibrinogen. Again, that same old song about fibrinogen being mixed up with other indicators and other risk factors. Well, what was interesting in this one was they found that significant relationship in females, but not in males. Now, what's the answer to that riddle or the question that brings up? I don't think we know yet. But again, bottom line is there is that association. Now, pardon me, this is another one of those issues where I'm having a little bit of trouble trying to get the visuals to work. I can see these, although I have to go up close to my screen to do it, and I'll read those off to you. The bottom line is, so what? What do you do with fibrinogen when you find elevated levels? This is another reason why you don't see a lot of discussion about fibrinogen among the standard medical practitioners, cardiologists, folks like that. Bottom line, there aren't FDA-approved drugs that work for this. And the things that you do for it are the things that you would do for the other indicators and the other risk factors. Platelet aggregation inhibitors such as aspirin, green tea, ginkgo, vitamin E. Vitamin A as well. Fish and olive oil. As a side point, elevated homocysteine levels do tend to decrease the breakdown of fibrinogen. And again, another relation of fibrinogen to another maybe soft indicator of risk. And then finally, for those of you who are interested in supplements and the impact, there's a significant amount of question and debate around giving vitamin C. So the antioxidants, vitamins A, C, and E, aspirin, green tea, ginkgo. And of course, the major risk factors. Again, you can't out-supplement a bad lifestyle. If you're smoking, game over. So stop smoking. That decreases fibrinogen. Obesity, avoiding obesity, again, obesity is a major risk factor. And then lowering LDL, that one's not quite as strong and quite as well documented. And here's a weird one, just red herring, totally out of the cold. Pardon the pun, but it's avoiding exposure to cold. Now, there's a lot of information which would indicate that maybe some of the there's some other biomarkers that might be healthy from brief exposures to cold. I'm not going to go down that bunny trail today. If you've made it this far, I appreciate your interest. And if you're interested in some of the bunny trails, some of the questions that come up from this, please let us know in the comments below.